Honored to be here with a very, very experienced panel who have so much sort of knowledge about the topic they're speaking on. And it was lovely to hear different ideas and innovative ways that there are people all around the world. There seems to be a special kinship between custodians, the word I like to use, of historic properties, given their, I feel there's a sense of duty and passion and responsibility, but also a sense of being able to be, to preserve the past and really be able to make it contemporary and useful for the future. I realize my video is off. I'm going to try putting it on. Okay. So to begin with, I kind of wanted to set the context of where really I'm telling you the story from. The area that I'm speaking about is Mayurbhanj in North Orissa. And it was one of the 575 princely states of the British India. The reason why this area is important historically is it has always sort of been a very rich naval history. It has had princely states. It was the largest of the, one of the Eastern princely states, but more than that, it had this very long line of succession from both indigenous tribal communities who then married into and had alliances with royal families from Rajasthan, the north. When we speak about historical properties in India, it's kind of hard to talk about them without these very magnanimous forts and palaces that have dominated sort of the cultural stereotype of Indian historical properties. However, Mayurbhanj and the eastern states were different. They were one of the first few areas which actually worked and sort of had alliances with the European colonial powers coming in. And for that reason, they started building houses for foreign dignitaries very, very early on. So Belgaria, the place that I'm going to speak about, had these very iconic women and men rulers, and they sort of were already covered. They were sort of already working and being able to collaborate with different foreign entities. It wasn't just the British, it was the French, it was the Portuguese, it was families from Southeast Asia. And this is the Belgaria Palace. It's my home. It's been in my family since the early 1800s. It was a guest house that was used by the erstwhile royal family to invite foreign dignitaries to come and invest in the state. So there was always an idea of being hospitable, of being able to invite and welcome new guests, new relatives, new friends, and really build on the idea of India. I know I'm speaking to a global audience, so I'm gonna try making references to people that, personalities that people may know, but one of the famous personalities we had come and stay with us was Mark Shand, the Duchess of Cornwall, Camilla Parker Bowles's brother, when he was traveling on his elephant Tara across India. Apart from that, there's a very big conglomerate in India called the Tatas. And the founder of the Tata conglomerate actually came and visited Mayurbhanj on invitation of the ruler, and impressed by its iron ore and natural resources, which was sort of the point of the invitation, he started the first iron ore and steel mine of India in 1904 in Mayurbhanj. And as we know, the rest is history. Tata is one of the biggest conglomerates out of India, and it kind of started from this very humble origins in this house. These are just two pictures of the rooms we had. We actually had these massive rooms with very high ceilings, antique furniture. There were trophies in every room. There was a bar cabinets in every room. And a lot of these rooms were bigger. We actually had to seal doors and make three rooms out of one room, because we were still trying to figure out who really would inhabit this space. It was definitely not being used anymore for the purpose it was intended. I think you can see me now. Moving on, this was another one of our rooms. This is our hallway. And this is very interesting. It's kind of hard to describe without being in the house. But like I said, the family moved in very, very recently. And we sort of did feel, the family wasn't living in Mayurbhanj anymore. They'd moved to a capital nearby, 4 hours away. But we felt a need to sort of restore it and do it in a way that had social equity and sustainability right in the middle of it. There was a sense of this being one of our last bastions of the family history. And we wanted to make it more of a platform than a property. So immediately before we started thinking of it as a hotel, the idea was, how will the space be used? Because the community finds no purpose in the house, it kind of disintegrates. someone very beautifully put it, right? These are places that sort of, well, the gardens are sort of living heritage pieces. And I think in a similar way, you know, these properties are as well. They are, they're of cultural significance to the community. They tell the story of the, you know, of an empire, of people, of the community's ancestors. And so rooms such as this on the right, which were projector and theater rooms, were actually projector and theater rooms in the past as well. These were Belgaria was mostly used for British governors or lords and ladies or, you know, investors. And so the idea was it was not as palatial as more of a leisure house. This became really important to us during the Bengal Renaissance era, which was the early 1900s in India. And, you know, Calcutta is the British capital. This house is about 4 hours away. And there's a fantastic love story, and I will post on the chat comment section. But you really saw a lot of artists, philosophers, cultural icons, movers and shakers inhabiting these rooms. The room you see on the left is actually one of the hallways in our upstairs wings. And if you look at the small doors right at the end, these were actually smaller rooms for valets and, you know, ladies in waiting for the men and women who came to the house. So we actually had rooms of, we have 9 rooms, but 22 in total, including our libraries and other leisure rooms, billiards rooms, snooker rooms, theater rooms, etc. These smaller rooms were also reused because we realized we wanted to tell the story of the house almost as if it was a living museum, just rooms being updated, but an element of the history being presented as well. If you can see on the left, this is the same room that's being reflected on the right. And, you know, I mean, you can, there's a certain similarity there, but at the same time, we tried to, we had a manifesto of sustainability pointers we wanted to stick to. Everything had to be upcycled. Everything had to be, you know, we used local help, sourced everything locally. We tried to make sure, because we are a natural disaster prone area, if there was extra wood, if there was extra materials that could be more environmentally friendly, environmentally conscious, that's what was used. We, except for the technical wiring and plumbing and, you know, electricity sort of technical issues, everything else in the house was kind of used the same. Just as a point of history, you know, Mayurbhanj had Mayurbhanj accessed from the Bay of Bengal right up left, and it sort of borders 3 different states. And the princesses who married into the family came from different kingdoms and countries. So my grandmother was the princess of Nepal, of the daughter of King Tribhuvan, and a part of my mother's from the royal family of Jaisalmer and Rajasthan. And so you had these unique elements of different families that came in, because whenever a woman got married into the family, she came with her entourage and women who sort of took over, dominated the staff and the kitchen. On the left, it's one of the architectural pieces of the Bhanja dynasty from the 14th century. This is a brick-built terracotta temple. And the history of my story has come from the architectural pieces from the 8th century, 14th century. And they kind of became our blueprint for the foundation and architecture of the house to not be changed. Our experiences were meant to be hyper-local and authentic. 2 years ago was when we opened up the house to become a homestay. This was extremely nerve-wracking for my family. And it was something that was a conscious decision, because we realized that if the house wasn't seen as a community center, in every essence of it, it would suddenly stop being as connected to the people around it. And we wanted to make sure there was a hint of the old, but we brought in people in. Bringing in the public was a huge part of making them feel this was also theirs. The picture on the right is actually from, there's a unique phenomenon in the east, in the state I come from in Orissa, called the Rath Yatra. It's literally called, you know, chariot walk. It is when people, you know, they make idols out of their gods, and they sort of parade them on this massive chariot. I don't know if you can tell from the pictures, but they usually go up to 50 to 100 feet. The unique thing about Mayurbhanj is that only women are allowed to pull the chariot in this very spiritual event. On the right is one of my ancestors actually doing the same thing on an elephant with the state army and, you know, a few other people, you know, behind him. Whereas on the left, that's my sister. The event still takes place. Last year was the 444th year. We actually did the event as a family with the community. A picture, this is just an interesting picture, because on the right, it's Dr. Annie Besant, who was an Irish theosophist who actually came to India and was invited by my ancestors to speak on Irish self-rule. Quite ironic, given this was definitely well before 1947. And on the left is one of my sister, who was curating an artist residency by a local artist conglomerate group. The idea was you use elements of what was happening in the past, for example, patronage, and you make it artist residencies. You use the fact that there were elements that the family had already used to work with the community, and we're sort of elaborating on that now. I wanted to speak about one event in particular. Mimi has been so gracious to invite me, and I think I've spoken about Belgaria, but I wanted to speak on one particular event that I think in 2 years of us being present, we've sort of been able to make a lot of impact with this, and it was called the Karkhana Chronicles. Karkhana in Hindi actually means atelier. These are workshops where craftsmen come and produce goods. They're usually associated with, it can be anything from textiles and fabric to workstations and historical properties in India. There were 575 royal families in the, in the 40s, over a period of time, different royal families signed on to merger agreements to make sure that they came under the Indian Union or the country, the new state of Pakistan. However, it was only in the 70s and then subsequently in the 80s where privy purses were sort of banned by the government. This was when, there was certain allocation of money from the state as decided during the merger agreements that went towards maintenance of these properties. As soon as that happened over the 80s and 90s, you had these tragic distress sales where, from 575 families, these were massive properties. Some of them were the largest private residences across, Asia. And it was hard to maintain them, hard to maintain the team for them. And but one thing that was very interesting was the custodianship of different arts and cultural practices, which these families, having had this community trust, seem to still be a part of. And so an idea was born called the Karkhana Chronicles. It was an international nonprofit agency that has come to India to talk about circular fashion. And I pitched them an idea, which was working with historical properties and their craft clusters and their artisans from their local communities and coming up with a textile installation, which we present across palaces. So in the first round, what we did was we actually managed, and the pandemic was horrible on the crafts cluster in India. And I'm not sure how many of you know, but it's one of the backbones of the unofficial market of India. And so what we actually did was we partnered with three different families from the north, west, and the east of India. And we tried this as an experiment where we took over forts and palaces, did these, worked with local artisan clusters to create installations. And then we invited the public. The idea was that innovation doesn't always have to happen in cities. And innovation is not just relegated to a few. We wanted to turn the idea of how textile traditions and cultural traditions that have sustainability or are historically significant to India are viewed by the public the same way they view historical properties today, which is from a sense of nationalism and pride. Also, it managed to tell the stories of these patrons and these custodians in a more humane way. There has been a sense of Indian royalties being looked at through what I call the Cartier and the Rolls-Royce era, which is, sort of this very grandeur, which gives them a lot of sense of privilege, which is hard to connect with them and hard to sort of see them as, in need of collaboration or just authentic people you'd want to be able to support in some way. And so, each of these installations carried the campaign's key message, which was not just talking about climate action and change in our textile history, but also talking about celebrating local practices and bringing more people, bringing the world to these iconic places and properties. Something I want to mention is the reach that something like this had. When we think about historical properties, there's such a way of doing something. I can't imagine my grandparents still being... They must have had a very different vision for the way the historical property would sort of be seen to the world. And I knew that something I could add was to make our voice more contemporary. And so when we do campaigns like this, we actually reach 2.5 million impressions by just being able to share our story digitally and being able to interview our artisans and interview members of who have made this house what it is today. And it is the community surrounding it and the artisans surrounding it and having their voice being amplified through our platform. For example, when we worked with Jaisalmer for this campaign, we actually had, 1,000 footfall even during COVID with precautions. And for them to see what was, in a sense, a shepherd's dress with local prints, fabrics, and weaving techniques in a royal palace was a sense of aspiration for, someone who would never think that the way they dress could be represented in a house such as this. we're actually going ahead and we got approval for a second round of this, which just makes it very exciting because that means that every time we do this, we have more and more historical properties that join us. And the second round, we're actually going to be taking this campaign to Mumbai in Maharashtra on the 10th of April at an interesting venue. The venue is actually a private members club that is, you know, has locations all around the world. And the reason why I chose to do it there, not in a gallery or public space, one is because of the COVID protocols we need to keep in place. But two was we need to be able to tell our stories in much more contemporary, relevant spaces where we're not just preaching to the choir, but going to places that are younger, have a more diverse age group, and they're much more in diverse fields and not just in architecture or history or interested in heritage or restoration. We need to be working with creatives and different storytellers. Our story is the same, but it needs to be changed the way it's told for a newer generation and audience. What I loved about working on a campaign like Karkana Chronicles, because now it's 7 royal families and 7 palaces, forts, and iconic properties taking part, is that now you're doing it and actually in a city where you can then, you're essentially networking and pitching your platform, your property, and you're saying, you know, come contribute to be part of these properties, making change on the ground, or come collaborate, you know, whether that's designers working with royal families and historical properties to come out with a collection of, say, sustainable bags, or whether it is, you know, each historical property for me has always been a brand on its own. It's always been houses that it's the most successful ones change a creative vision and leadership every couple of decades, but in essence, they stay true to who they are and what they stand for. Mayurbhanj has always been known as the land of art and culture. We are famous for our indigenous practices and folk dances of dance, of song, of the spoken word, and of course our textiles and our crafts. And a lot of this is endangered. A lot of this is our living heritage, and we need to be mindful of the fact that we are in a position where we still enjoy privilege, but we can actually take our platform and use our voice and be able to share it with others and create something quite beautiful that makes these houses and their brands and legacies last a lifetime. Something that the reason why I screenshot this image is because it's Vogue. But you know, the image that Vogue chose to use as the cover story for when they covered the Karkana Chronicles was a Santali sari. It's an indigenous sari. It's worn by a certain tribe in India called the Santhals that are found across the central east and some parts of the north. And I showed it to someone who is my colleague. She's part of the hospitality team because we only hire locally. Some of them haven't gone to hospitality school. And she said, that's what my grandmother wears, but I've forgotten the drape. I never knew it would be ever seen in a palace. And she kind of went back to her grandmother and kind of, you know, tried to see if she could, you know, wear something. And there was obviously something for her. It was just, you know, there was a sense of wearing jeans and a shirt that was more popular these days. But I liked the fact that through using, by experimenting with the different visual imagery and a vocabulary and tone, you actually connected with audiences you never thought had a stake in the running of your historical property. And for the same reason, you know, it was very important for us to start telling our story with more diversity, with more inclusion, with really not trying to be tone deaf with the movements which are so social, political, and cultural happening around you today. I started taking stories of my ancestors and pitching them to brands who'd like to come and recreate old styles, making sure we're working with sustainable brands when they want to shoot a campaign somewhere. We were really excited because we were covered by Condé Nast Traveler the first year we opened up, of just being an offbeat place, telling a different story. And we, you know, this image at the bottom, the graphic is of annual artist residencies, yoga retreats that we do, that we try to make sure we keep getting people who are themselves interesting, innovative, telling a different story. But really, you're centered between policy and pop culture, and you could really make some on-ground change. We have something called I'm going to end on one note. It is the Mayurbhanj Foundation. And a percentage of the funds raised from people staying with us actually go back into community activities, whether that's working in reviving an old form of martial arts dance called Mayurbhanj Chow, whether it's making sure that artisans are getting equal and fair pay and fair wages through our program of working with Dokra artisans, again, an endangered art form in India with local tribal communities. And third, making sure we have enough, you know, we do volunteer activities and we have saved up, you know, a sum which can actually help local communities when, you know, when we, wherever we can raise up development indicators with impact. So this was just a little bit of the presentation. I think all that I can add is a personal anecdote of someone who is trying as part of a different generation, but trying to make sure that I make my ancestors proud, and I keep the property in the heart of the community as it was intended to be about 200-300 years ago, and do it in a way that is true to who we are. Bring up the fact that we do keep social equity, we keep women at the center of the conversation. We want to keep local indigenous communities at the center of this conversation. And we really build a strong cultural brand that gives back to people and through that is able to sustain itself. Thank you so much.
Fantastic. Akshita, every time I hear you, I'm really truly inspired. It's fantastic. And I love the idea of being innovative by actually reinventing what was there before. As you say, patronage can now result in an artist in residence program, et cetera, et cetera.